गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। गुड
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
मॉर्निंग। सो इन द प्रीवियस क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द सम ऑफ द इंटरवेंशंस दैट वाज डिजाइंड बाय द रामसा program, and in that discussion we have seen the intervention that was designed on the part of the infrastructural facility. So that was over. In this class, today class, we will see about the other intervention strategy that was under the Ramsar program, and I think that we have started also. So even though we have started the some of the intervention program framed for the Ramsar program, but we will start from the beginning. I think I was started discussing the quality intervention. The infrastructural intervention was completed, and in this class we will see the quality intervention, means whatever what kind of a intervention strategy was designed within this framework of program for the quality improvement. Because we see whenever we talk about the SSA and RAMSA, we know that both the program was focused on the qualitative improvement as well as the quantitative improvement. So for the quantitative improvement, we have seen that secondary school was opened at a distance of 5 kilometer from the residence of children, and the senior secondary school was opened within the radius of 7 to 10 kilometer. And for the qualitative improvement, some of the infrastructural facilities that was proposed to provide. Apart from that, for the other things was also provided, like how to enhance the quality of teaching learning that was happening at a school level. And for that, the first intervention strategy that was suggested by this program was to have a PTR, that is the people teacher ratio. People teacher ratio was supposed to bring at a 30:1, means for a 30 student there will be one teacher, so that the teacher can give a proper attention to each and every child. Teacher can monitor the progress of the child while teaching learning process is happening, and teacher can have a eye on the holistic development of the child. Because if the teacher and student ratio will increase, then it will be difficult for the teacher to see all the children that how they are progressing. Because when we talk about the RAMSA, and it was implemented in 2009, so this was the time when the constructivism was very much populated in the country. The era of behaviorism was outdated, and we were talking about the constructivism. So for having a constructivist classroom and a teacher to act as a facilitator of a learning, it was very important to give attention to every individual child. And that's why the RAMSA was focusing that there should be a very sound teacher student ratio. And they suggest, means the program suggest, that the teacher-student ratio should be at least 30:1. And that's why when we see this RAMSA and SSA program, when this program was implemented, a number of teacher have been recruited in a school at a elementary level also, at a secondary level also. But here one thing important to mention, that recruiting a teacher and giving them a salary was having a huge financial implication, that is the financial burden on the part of a state, because this RAMSA and SSA program was not implemented only for the central government school but also for the state government school. And in any state, the majority of the schools are run by the state government. So if they will recruit a lot of a teacher in order to maintain the 30:1 teacher student ratio, sorry, student teacher ratio, so it will have a financial burden on the part of the state. And that's why they have devised one formula. It may not be very much appropriate, it may not be very much praiseworthy, but they have adapted to have a community teacher. Means the teacher will be recruited through the local governance, like a Panchayati Raj institution, like that. And the government will fund them, and the fund will be utilized for remuneration of the teacher. And in that fashion, a lot of teacher have been recruited, and the nomenclature of those teacher were different in the different state. Like that, in the Jharkhand, it is a Siksha Sahayak. In the Orissa also, Siksha Sahayak. In the Bihar, it is a Siksha Mitra. Like that, there was some nomenclature given to them. But on the policy, whatever it was, the implementation strategy, I know that it was not very much praiseworthy implementation strategy for recruiting the teacher, because we have seen that a lot of teacher have been recruited in the school system, those were not competent enough to teach in the school. And even the lot of teacher have been recruited without having a teacher training degree, means without having the training how to teach the student. So that was the one of the challenges whenever we talk about this point, that is providing adequate number of a teacher in a school and bringing down the PTR, pupil teacher ratio, to 30:1. Okay, so that was the one of the big challenge. And like that, we have done this also. Now on the next thing, for improving the quality of a teaching learning process at a secondary level, the program, that is the RAMSA policy framework, emphasize that there should be focus on science, mathematics and English education. I think that I have started discussing that point in the study class. Here it is necessary to mention that it talks about the focus. It doesn't mean that the other subject, like that the social science, like that the other language, like that the physical education, even the activities related to co-curricular things, was deprioritized. It was not deprioritized, it was also in the topmost priority, and that's why all those subjects was there when we see the syllabus of the secondary school. But it talks that apart from all other subject, these three subjects should be prioritized. and there was a specific reason also. The reason behind including the English language in the secondary level was that whenever we go for the higher education, in the majority of the institution, the higher education are imparted in the English language. In the India, I am talking about the India, not the other country. Across the states, even you can pursue, suppose that a person want to pursue a science, want to do plus 2, plus 3, that is a graduation and a PG in science. The majority of institution offer plus 2 science in an English language. Very few institution offer plus 2 science in a regional language like a Hindi, Oriya, Bengali, like that. And when we go to the graduation, you won't find the quality textbook, quality literature in the regional language. You will find the quality textbook and literature in an English language only. And English is seen to be an international language. And that's why the government has thought, in order to give a holistic exposure to the student studying at a secondary level and to provide a path for the vertical movement. Vertical movement means to go in the educational studies hierarchically at a different stages of learning, like that the elementary is the one stage, secondary is another one stage which is hierarchically higher than the elementary, then the you can talk about that is the higher secondary, then graduation, then post graduation, then the MPhil, PhD, like that. So it this kind of a hierarchy in the education is known as a vertical movement, vertical hierarchy. So in order to provide a vertical movement in the education, it was necessary to have a English fluency, reading, writing, learning fluency in the English. So that's why the English was included. Science, why it was included? Because when we study, when we get education, one of the motto of getting education, aim, broader aim of imparting education is to overcome from the superstition, ill practices, witchcraft, like that kind of a thing. So, to overcome from the this type of a practices. But in order to come out of those type of practices, it is very much required to have a understanding over the reason on the natural phenomena. Whatever the natural phenomena is happening in and around us, what is the reason? That logical reasoning needs to be developed. The children must know the reason. What are the reason? And in order to provide the exposure to those reasons, the science was imparted. Now, the mathematics, as I have started discussion in the previous class also, so I will just bring forward those discussion. We know that the mathematics have a different kind of a nature, and in fact, every discipline have their own distinct nature. And that's why there is a necessity of studying different pedagogy for different discipline. Otherwise, there was a no necessity of having a different pedagogy paper. And the nature of mathematics is, it is a precise science. It has a precision. It has an accuracy, accurate to the point. Suppose that I will tell 2 plus 2. It will always 4. It won't be less than 4, it won't be more than 4. Okay, so there is a accuracy, there is a precision, and while solving the mathematical problem, we learn how to solve the real life problem also. And in the previous discussion, I was talking about the one of the problem solving steps has been given by the George Polya. And George Polya suggests that in order to solve any problem, not only related to the mathematics, but from the real life also, you have to understand the problem. What is the problem? What is the problem means, what are the premises of the problem? What are the condition of the problem? And what kind of a solution we require? For sake of example, if I am saying that if I have a parallelogram, then the diagonal will bisect each other. If we have a parallelogram, then its diagonal will bisect each other. Bisect means it will divide it into two parts. So, what is the premises? Premises is that we have a parallelogram. So, all the feature of a parallelogram here we can use. Then the condition is the parallelogram have a diagonal, and diagonal is by intersecting, means cutting. Then what kind of a solution we want? That we have to show that the diagonals are bisecting. Suppose that this is the diagonal, so this part and this part will be equal, this part and this part will be equal. So we have a premise, we have a condition, and we need a solution. So in this framework, what kind of a strategy we will design to come with a desired solution? And that's why the George Polya talks that we have to understand, and then we have to devise a plan, then we have to carry out a plan, and then we have to take a feedback, looking back. Feedback in the sense that if same or a similar problem we will face in the future, so at that time we will see that previously whatever the design we have adapted to solve the problem, to which extent it was useful, or what kind of a modification is required. And that is not only in the area of mathematics, in the life also. If you face a certain some sort of a problem, you have to identify what are the problem and what is my condition, and within that problem, within that condition means what I have. It may be finance, it may be emotional setup, it may be cognitive level, it may be your level of education, it may be norms of society, like that. And within that framework, what kind of a solution I need, and in order to achieve those kind of a solution, what kind of a strategy you can plan, adapt. So when we talk about the mathematics, mathematics has a variety of role in a real life problem and also for the academic purpose. Suppose that the student want to pursue science in higher education level. So for pursuing science, they must know mathematics, because without knowing mathematics, you cannot study physics, you cannot study chemistry, you cannot study biology, you cannot study biotechnology. So it is a very much impossible kind of a thing, or a difficult kind of a thing. And whenever I used to talk with the student of a B.Ed, when they come, especially when I take the mathematics pedagogy paper, I used to ask, so why you have studied mathematics? Majority of the student who have studied science, because when I take the mathematics pedagogy, I have a student with the mathematics major and the student with the science major also, suppose that are physics and chemistry. So they say I was interested to study science at a higher education level, but in order to study science it is necessary to study mathematics, that's why I have studied mathematics. So the implication of mathematics in our life is so much that we cannot ignore it, and that's why these three subjects have been focused, emphasized. But it doesn't mean that the other subject is deprioritized, that was also having the equal priority, but the focus, main focus was that, because their importance is very huge. Okay, so before proceeding towards the next point in the quality intervention, we will have a small question break, that is a doubt clearing session. Anybody having the any doubt or any question up to here? Anybody? Are you getting me? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, there is no question. Then, do you have any question? Okay. So, if you will get any question or doubt, you can put your doubt or question in the chat. I will see the chat box. So, the next step was to ensure the quality of teaching learning in the secondary education was to improve the in-service teacher training program. It was also to emphasize or to improve, strengthen pre-service teacher training program. But side by side, it was also emphasized that to improve and strengthen the in-service teacher training program. Why? Because the domain of teaching and learning is changing at a rapid stage. And the second thing is that with the new researches in the area of teaching and learning, a new type of a strategy, methodology and new things are coming in the area of teaching and learning. But think of those who have undergone the teaching learning program, pre-service teaching learning program few years back, 5 to 10 years back, what will be the situation to them? They won't be equipped with the recent latest methods of teaching and learning. They won't be equipped. Why? Because at that time, those type of a teaching learning methodology was not developed, and that's why they have been not oriented. For sake of example, we can talk about the process-based assessment, how to do, what it is, they may not be knowing. Or to integration of tools of ICT, they may not be knowing. Or how to handle the tools of ICT for teaching with the online mode of communication, they may not be knowing. So, in order to give them exposure about all those things, it was necessary to strengthen the in-service teacher training program. And it was basically focused to orient them about the new method strategy of teaching learning, engaging the learner in the learning situation. That was the major emphasis of having a in-service teacher training program and strengthening it. So this was the area that was also focused for improving the quality of secondary school education, that is the quality intervention. Other thing also includes like that the making available science laboratory, or if the science laboratory is there, then making it functional and strengthening it. Again, the concept of functional will come here. Like that, yesterday we were talking the functional toilets. We have seen that so many schools have a toilet, but it is not functional. Likewise, so many schools have a laboratory, so many schools have a library, but it is not functional. It is not being opened. Students are not being allowed to do the experiment or enter in the library to learn, read. So here the emphasis was to strengthen and make the laboratory in the school functional. If they have a laboratory, if they don't have a laboratory, then the establishment of the laboratory in the school, that was emphasized in the policy framework of Ramsa. And why it talks about the strengthening of and making the availability of the laboratory? Because the policy framework has of a Ramsa has emphasized on three subjects, that is the science, mathematics and English. And we know that in order to have a holistic learning of a science, or to have a better understanding of the scientific concept, whatever they are learning in the school, to have a holistic idea and to have a clear-cut understanding of those concepts, they must be given opportunity to observe, to verify and to experiment those things. Because if they won't get opportunity to observe, to verify and to experiment, the kind of learning that they will have, it will be very, very rote learning. Suppose that in the science, physical science, I will tell that the value of acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 meter per second. Then the obvious thing is that question may come in the mind of a student, that why it is 9.8 meter per second, why it is not more than that, why it is not less than that. Okay, and how to calculate it, and the more important thing is that why I will believe it that it is 9.8 meter per second. Okay, so science is a subject that requires a verification of the scientific concept. That is the one thing. The second thing is that in science, developing a skill, motor skill to do the experiment is also important thing. Suppose that very much theoretically I have taught you that the value of small g, that is the acceleration due to gravity, is 9.8 meter per second square. It doesn't mean that you will be able to experiment and show and demonstrate the activity. It doesn't mean, because in order to demonstrate, you must have a hands-on experience. And that's why the laboratory, science laboratory development and establishment, the strengthening of science laboratory was emphasized in this program policy framework of this program. Then the other thing was the ICT enabled classroom. That was also emphasized that tools of ICT must be available in the school and in the classroom, because it was framed and launched in the year 2009, and at that time a lots of tools of ICT were developed and their strength was established by several researchers. So it was the time where we cannot ignore the potential of the tools of ICT in having a better teaching learning environment in the classroom. That was there. So it was also included. And at the last, and again in the last, we will have a question answer session. But before that, that one of the major intervention that was planned for the quality intervention was curriculum reform, teaching learning reform. The curriculum must have a relevant part. It must not include so much of a thing that will become a burden to the student, and the student will be demotivated from the learning. Because if the so much of a content is there, the student will be demotivated, it will be extra burden to them. Okay, so that was also emphasized that the curriculum framework, the textbook should be revised in the light of the recent development in that area, and the teaching learning process must include the varieties of teaching learning strategy. Together with it should be a child centric, where the student must get an enough opportunity for exploring the things. Okay, so this was the all about the sixth point that the policy framework of Ramsa talks about on the part of quality intervention. This sixth point was emphasized there. So that is now over, and in the next class we will see about the equity intervention for the Ramsa program. So now we will have a question answer session. So any question up to this point of discussion, that is whatever discussed today, as well as if you have a doubt from the previous discussion also.
Hello, sir.
In this series,
हाँ.
You can ask now.
Sir, वो जो CBSE का course होता है.
Any question?
वो तो NCERT के सब syllabus के हिसाब से वो पढ़ते हैं वो बच्चे. तो CBSE में जो plus two रहता है, जैसे कि DAV school वगैरह, तो उनके plus two के time में बच्चे लोगों को सिर्फ जो science के lab में instrument दिखाए जाते हैं, उसके uses बताए जाते हैं, मगर experiment नहीं होता है. जैसे मेरे दोस्त लोग जब ग्रेजुएशन में आए, प्लस टू उनका डीएवी में था और मेरा सीएचएसई में था, तो मैंने हर प्रैक्टिकल किया था उससे. तो वो लोग बोलते थे कि हमने तो ये सब किया नहीं, हमको सिर्फ दिखा देते थे टीचर लोग कि ये इसका नाम ये है, इसका यूज ऐसा होता है. तो एनसीईआरटी तो वो लोग बोलते थे कि कहता है कि एनसीईआरटी फॉलो करता है. हाँ,
ओके. सी यहाँ पे, हाँ, आई गोट योर पॉइंट. द यू आर ट्राइंग टू से दैट द एनसीईआरटी हैज डिवाइज्ड अ करिकुलम फ्रेमवर्क, इवन द टेक्स्ट बुक फॉर द सीबीएसई मीडियम स्कूल, वेयर द स्टूडेंट्स आर ओनली सीइंग द इक्विपमेंट, नॉट हैविंग द हैंड्स ऑन एक्सपीरियंस, वेयर एज you are from the state board but you had a experience of doing the experiment. So this question has a two part. The first part I will like to say that the responsibility of framing curriculum framework, curriculum and the syllabus, even the textbook, is given to the NCERT at a central level. Okay, at a central level. Like that, the state also have a similar kind of a structure. Like that, when we talk about the Orissa Textbook Publishing Corporation, there is a body which used to publish the textbooks. When we talk about the Bihar Textbook Publishing Corporation, DTC, is the body which used to prepare the textbook for the Bihar state. Okay. So, at a national level, NCERT has been given the responsibility. At a state level, different agency have been given the responsibility. But there is no very strict rule that you cannot adopt the central level textbook, means that is the developed by the NCERT. Like that, when we talk about the Jharkhand, they have simply adapted the textbook developed by the NCERT with some modification, because in the state flavor should come, state priority should come. So they have little bit modified and they have adapted it. Like that, the science and mathematics, they have directly adapted as it is. In toto, it has been published by taking the copyright permission. So it is not a hard and fast rule on the part of a syllabus, textbook and other things. And the second thing is that the your friend who were in the CBSE medium, they were not getting the scope and opportunity for practical. It is not like the policy framework. It is like that the sometime the school may not have the facility, sometime they don't have a staff, sometime they are not very much interested also. So the variety of reason is there. There is no single reason why some school they don't have a practical in the science. Okay, variety of reason is there. Nowadays even we have a mathematics laboratory also. But when I was in the school, we don't know, we were not knowing at that time that there is a such kind of a concept, there is a such kind of a laboratory, that is a mathematics laboratory. So we were not knowing even. So it is a limitation or it is a problem with that particular school. It is not a problem with the policy framework. Even in the state board school, you are fortunate enough that you have got opportunity to have a hands-on experience, but many students are not getting. Okay, so it depends upon the management of the school that how they are doing all those things. It is a not problem from the policy level, or it is not problem with the curriculum framed or a syllabus framed or a textbook developed. Okay, it is not like that. Even I remember when I was in school, the laboratory work was there given in the textbook. But the school I was knowing at that time, none of them had a laboratory, or some of them had a equipment for the practical. Not a laboratory, but the equipment they were having and they were keeping in some place. But they were never bringing them out. They were never bringing. I remember when I was in the 10th class, so we were supposed to prepare a laboratory notebook. And how we will prepare the laboratory notebook? When we do practical in the laboratory, then we will bring. But nothing happened to us. So just we have purchased a book and 2, 3, 4, 5 lab experiment we have written. So like that, the situation was there. But it was not like that, the equipment was not in the school. It was there. Even I don't know about the Orissa, but in the Jharkhand and Bihar, I have seen in the majority of the that is the plus two school or a college, because we have an intermediate college like that. You have a junior college in Orisha, so different nomenclature is there. I think when I was discussing the NPE 2020, that time I have discussed that there are several nomenclature that will be removed in this policy. So we had a we have a intermediate college, and they don't have a laboratory session. They don't provide a hands-on experiences. So this kind of a situation is there, but it is not problem with the policy. It is not problem with the curriculum and the other things. It is totally the fault of the school. Okay. Other things? Any question? Subhashri Panigrahi is asking, sir, what is process based assessment? Process based assessment, several time I used to talk in the B.Ed and M.Ed. I think either I am not able to make you understand, or there is something else. When we talk about the assessment, okay, so there is a two paradigm of assessment. One paradigm is the product based, another paradigm is a product based. When we talk about, yes, someone is trying to say something. No, okay. So I am continuing. So when we talk about the product based assessment says that the assessment will be at the end of session, wherein your final write up in the terms of a examination will be examined. And on the basis of performance in that examination, you will be assessed that how much you have learned, means your progress, academic achievement. Whereas the process-based assessment talks that the assessment will not be a year-end phenomena, year-end affair, whereas the process will be inbuilt in the teaching-learning process, where the teacher will be teaching and they will be observing, they will be maintaining, noting down that how you are processing over the time period, what kind of a difficulty you are facing, what are your strength, like that. And so that there will be two things. One thing is that teacher will be getting feedback from your performance and achievement, and they will be able to appropriately devise a plan for better engaging you in the teaching learning process. And the second most important thing will be that your achievement will be not only based upon the year-end examination, year-end examination, whereas your performance will be shown in terms of that how you have progressed over the year. Okay, so that is the process base, and that one is the product base. Some chat is there, message in the chat box. Sir, is RAMSA only focused on in service teacher training, not in the pre service teacher training? See, the answer of the question is yes also, no also. So how it is, see. So when we talk about the RAMSA program was basically focused on making available the quality secondary education to all children. Means it has a two component. Quantitative improvement, means increasing the number of school to the locality of the child, and the qualitative improvement means to enhance the quality of the education that is being imparted in the secondary school. So whatever required for the quantity was to improve the number of school, and whatever the required for the quality, okay. So we have seen several things, and we will see other things in the next class also, But one of the thing is that the in-service teacher program, because the in-service teacher program is within the framework of the policy. Because once the teacher is in the class, so they can, the teacher is in the school, so they can have a program for their professional development, for their training. But when we talk about the pre-service teacher education, means they are not yet recruited, because they have not completed the teacher training program. They are not in the school system, they are not appointed in the school. So if they are not a teacher, they are not a teacher, na, because they have not completed the course, they are not being appointed in the school. So when we talk as per the policy, as per the rules and regulation, they are not a teacher till now, because they are undergoing the training. So if they are not a teacher, so it is not within the scope of this program to organize some program for that, because all other required program are supposed to be organized by the Teacher Preparation Institute, and that is being regulated by the NCTE. So since they are not a teacher, so how the Ramsar will have a program for them? Once they will be recruited, so the Ramsar will take care of the professional development, training, orientation, all those kind of a thing. And that's why they talk only the in-service teacher training program,
yes,
not
sir,
the pre-service
yes,
teacher training program, because in the pre-service teacher training program, you are not a teacher at all. Is it okay, Shashmita?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other thing? No question.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So I think we can stop the today's session up to here only. So thank you for being with me. Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.